Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Hearty welcome to today's CPE conference on GST and NextGen accountant. Friends, to inaugurate today's seminar, we have invited an eminent banker, head of HDFC Limited, CA KP Aggarwal is with us. May I request a branch chairman to escort him onto a dais. And also the first technical session speaker, CA Jatin Christopher is with us. May I request our treasurer to escort him onto a dais. Request chairman to welcome KP Aggarwal with the flower bouquet. Please welcome Mr. KP Aggarwal. Request treasurer to welcome our first technical session speaker, CA Jatin Christopher. Now I request chairman to make welcome address.
Shuklam Bharadram Vishnum, Shashi Varnam Chatur Bhujam, Prasanna Vadanam Dhyayet Sarva Vigno Pashantaye. Today's chief guest is Sri K.P. Aggarwal, the first technical session speaker, C.A. Jatin Christopher, BT Shetty, the dynamic secretary of Bangalore branch, and young and energetic treasurer, Srinivas Shetty. All my esteemed speakers for the 2 days programs, and my dear esteemed members of our profession and the members of our branch, good morning to all of you. Good morning. Friends, Parishilana, 2 days CPE conference is organized at a short notice. Last 10 days back, we decided to have this program as part of additional programs required to complete the CPE programs. Many members need to complete their CPE hours for the December closing. For that purpose, we thought let us have a bigger program. And to inaugurate this program, we requested Sri K.P. Aggarwal to come forward. He has been heading as business at the Karnataka and Goa for HDFC Limited, the housing finance and related business. When we approached him through Way to Wealth, the CEO, I was amazed. He has readily agreed to be part of it. Then luckily, he has been on a holiday mood. And we said, we will be better utilizing your holiday time for our purpose. So he has readily agreed to be part of us. On behalf of Bangalore branch and all the members present here, I extend warm welcome to you, sir. Friends, any program on GST, we always think about my guru, C.A. Jatin Christopher. He was talking, teaching central excise and the customs law for me when I was studying my CA. I was sitting in all the benches there and learning each time because I was repeated the CA exam. But after attending his session, I got exemption in the customs and central excise papers. Even today I remember the valuation rules and all that he was talking about on the customs law side. Even today I don't forget it. That's the kind of very effective speaking and the teaching skill that Jatin Christopher has. Therefore, to have a GST session to be more effective, we thought let us have Jatin Christopher with us to be the opening batsman to start with the first technical session. He has readily agreed to be part of the today's program. On behalf of all of you present here and also on behalf of the Bangalore branch managing committee members, I extend warm welcome to C.A. Jatin Christopher. Friends, as you know, any program that we conduct, only one source of inspiration is the response from all of you. For today's program, more than 670 members registered till yesterday, and even today also many members are entering in as a spot registration, and that is the kind of support and motivation for us to conduct as many programs as possible. Therefore, any success of our program not only depending upon the speakers here, but also depends upon how many chairs are occupied in the hall. Today, I am sure, you know, maybe because of the tax, you know, scrutiny seasons or whatever, people may be a little late, but I am 100% confident that all the chairs will be occupied today in another couple of minutes' time. And I extend warm welcome to each one of you for your active participation for making this program a grand success. Friends, why this program, 2 days program called Parishilana? I wanted to just tell about one or two words about that, because most of our programs are having some name, whether it is Vidvat Sabha, Tarka Sabha, Vichara Goshti, Visharada, whatever. This program we wanted to call it as Parishilana, because as we move towards December and thinking about 2020 next year, we have to complete CPE programs, hours on the one side, and at the same time, we need to look back and see last 1 year, what is it that we have done? So Parishilana means it's the introspection. Look into ourselves. Are we relevant today? If you see in the board also, it's mentioned, you know, we are in the race for relevance because of the changing dynamics, the technology taking over on the profession and making its own prominence. Therefore, we need to stay relevant in the today's profession in whatever that we do, may it be a test function, may it be consulting or audit or whatever it is. Therefore, the introspection is inevitable for us. And we need to be ready for change also. After looking at the, you know, having completed the introspection, we need to figure out where are the weaknesses and how do we strengthen it as we move forward. Therefore, we need to be ready for radical change. Unless we are ready for radical change, we will be losing our relevance in the future. Therefore, we thought, let us have this program. So Parishilana followed by the introspection and then being ready for the radical change, I'm sure abundant opportunities are opening up in front of us. So it's unleashing the potential that we have. Friends, today many proprietary concerns and small CA firms are giving up their statutory audit, and internal audit has been losing its charm since technology has been fully implemented and CAs are not that much tech savvy. Though they are good at technology, but not that much tech savvy. Therefore, when so many people are giving up the audit, a vacuum is getting created. There's a lot of new opportunities opening up. So we need to upskill ourselves and reposition so that we will be able to grab this opportunity now. So big opportunity is coming ahead of us and we need to look forward and grab that. Therefore, we thought this Parishilana 2 days conference is going to make a lot of difference. First day we are talking about the GST and the second day it is the next generation digital accountants. Somebody was telling about the blockchain and he went on telling that, you know, you have learned a double entry system of bookkeeping which is going to go away in due course. There is going to be triple entry system of bookkeeping. I do not know what exactly is the triple entry system and how it is going to be balanced, but the technology is going to drive that. That means we need to relearn many things in the future so that we will stay relevant in the future. Therefore, we thought, okay, Parishilana is going to be the apt name for the 2 days program. Friends, as we move forward, a lot of programs are getting lined up. One more important program is the annual refresher program, which is scheduled in Sirsi, which is my native place. I need to tell one or two words about you know, why it is held in Sirsi. It's called Sahyadri Sambrama, and it's held in a place called, very small place called Sirsi, which is 30 kilometers away from Western Ghats called Yana. You know, Yana is very much known for its own historical values. You must be aware about Bhasmasura Mohini story, where Bhasmasura does his tapas and Ishwara comes and gives the boon. And the boon is that, you know, if Bhasmasura puts his head on anybody's his hand on anybody's head, that person will turn to be ash. He gets that boon from Ishwara and he wanted to try on Ishwara's head itself. Ishwara went on running, and he went into the cave there. And he seeked the help of Vishnu. Vishnu came in the form of Mohini and started dancing. And finally, he attracted Bhasmasura also, made Bhasmasura to dance. And finally, as part of the dancing, he has put his head on Bhasmasura's, his hand on the Bhasmasura's head, and Bhasmasura became the ash then. You know that story. This happened in that place called Yana. So we wanted to see such a nice, wonderful place as part of our refresher program. Therefore, I request members, if you are interested, definitely register for that program, and it's going to be highly helpful for all of us. Friends, Institute has been conducting many programs for the benefit of members, including revamping of our coaching classes and revamping of our website and the mobile apps. Today, if you want to give feedback for any programs, the feedback form is available in our ICI mobile app. It will help us to structure programs better. It will help us to improve the quality of the speakers, quality of the presentations, the quality of the amenities that we provide for the members. I request all of you to take a minute and download. Anyway, enough apps are there in your mobile. Giving little more space for ICI Bangalore app is definitely possible. Request you to download ICI mobile app from Google Play Store. Register that, and please give the feedback for today's and tomorrow's programs. That will be definitely helpful to us. With these words, once again, I welcome each other, nephew. Happy learning for 2 days. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chairman, for a fabulous welcome address with the Bhasmasura Mohini story. Friends, it is my pleasure to introduce today's chief guest to this August gathering. Our guest, CA KP Aggarwal, is a member of our institute since 2001 and also a member of Institute of Chartered Accountants of England and Wales in the year 2013. He's also acquired executive MBA from S.P. Jain Institute of Management and Research in 2012. He worked as in manufacturing sector, also a merchant banker before joining ICICI Bank mortgage department. After that, he joined HDFC Limited and working there since the last 15 years in various positions. Currently, he is a head of business Karnataka and Goa. More than that, a fascinating personality, CA KP Aggarwal. Please join me to welcome him once again. Friends, I also introduce our first technical session speaker, CA Jatin Christopher. Jatin Christopher qualified in the year 2000. And he is specialized in indirect taxes. He is an invitee of Indirect Tax Committee of ICAI, and he is into the litigation, mainly litigation practice of indirect tax. He is presently partner of GCSS, a leading chartered accountant firm in Bangalore. More than that, a very helpful person, and whenever we invite him for our requirement, he readily accepts our invitation. He is really a resource for an excellent resource for Bangalore, and across India he travels and he shares his precious time and knowledge with all of us. Please welcome him once again. With this brief introduction, please welcome him. Friends, let us seek Almighty's blessing through lighting the lamp. I request dignitaries on the dais to do the honor.
यैष सुप्तेषु जाग्रति यैष सुप्तेषु जाग्रति
Friends, Almighty blessed us. Now I request our chief guest to address us.
Now, Chairman C.A. Shivram Bhatt, other dignitaries, respected senior members present here, friends, wish you a very, very happy good morning. Yeah, I'm giving time to you to respond. First of all, I would thank C.A. Shivram Bhatt and the Institute to call me for the inauguration of Parishilan. Parishilan means deep study, and who can know better deep study than a chartered accountant? I'm humbled to be a part of this event, to be present in front of respected members. I'm speaking for the first time in the Institute. I speak in a lot of corporate conferences, but I think this is my first opportunity to speak in front of the respected members, and I'm really delighted to do that. Yesterday when I got a call, I got a call on Saturday to be a part of this event, and I was just thinking as to what should I talk, what topic should I talk in this event. In the midst of financial crisis, economic slowdown, and protest and dharnas happening across the country. So I thought, let me not talk about something which is crisis and something which is slowdown or something which is related to the political instability. I thought, let us discuss something which is futuristic, and let us talk about opportunities. I strongly think that India is all poised to be the third largest economy by 2030. So let us see what's happening in India. So let us compare let us compare India with China. So let us compare India and China. So China is a 14.4 trillion economy in 1819. So for being a 14 trillion economy by 1819, and China was 10 trillion economy in 2011. So what happened in China? From 1979 to 2011, for almost 12 years, China grew by a CAGR of 9.9% for 12 years. So if India has to be a 10 trillion economy by 2030, India has to grow by 9% CAGR year on year from here on. Some of the other dynamics between India and China are, the population of China is about 1.42 billion as 1819, and India is about 1.37. But the growth rate of Indian population is about 1.11% with respect to China at 0.35%. India's current GDP is about $2.7 trillion. While China is at $14 trillion. So China is already 5.5 times of where India is today. If you adjust the GDP with PPP, India is at about $11.4 trillion and China is about $27.4 trillion. So again, China is about 2.5 times what India's GDP is today, okay, if we adjust the PPP from the GDP. The per capita income of China as of now is about 5 times of what India is. So India is about $2,000 per capita income. China is about $10,000 per capita income. The forex reserve of China is upwards of $3,000 billion. India is about $420 billion. I think it has just current data shows India is about $450 billion. The external debt of India is about $519 billion. So if you compare the external debt to the forex reserve, we are almost 1.2 ratio. China external debt is about $1,900 billion. So China's debt is less than the forex reserve of China. So the forex reserve is about $3,000 billion, but the external debt is only $1,900 billion. So China, in terms of its forex reserves, is very, very safe as where India is. The population growth is almost 1/3 of where India is. The GDP is 5.5 times of where India is. So if India has to touch where China is, India has to really do very good in the last 10 years. And this is the time where India has got stuck with the economic slowdown, where our GDP growth has gone less than 6%, where we should be ideally at about 9% or above 9% today. The GDP growth in India, I think the latest data was 5.2%. If we average it out for the last 3 years, we are about 6.5% GDP growth. So let us see what's driving India. So which are the sectors that are driving India? We can surely say agriculture, industrial, and infra is driving India. So our in India, the steel production is about 107 million ton. We are the second largest steel manufacturers of in the world. Our cement production is about 502 million ton. We are in cement, again, the second largest manufacturers in the world. Our two-wheeler production is about 5.1 million units every year. We manufacture more than 50 lakh units every year. We are the largest in the world in the manufacturing of two-wheelers. Our construction activities in India is about 1 billion square feet every year. But in construction, we are the seventh in the India. We rank seventh in construction. So I think this is one area where we can really do good. Our wireless connection is about 1162 million connections we have. So our penetration of wireless connection to the population is very good. Our population is about 137, and our wireless connection is about 116. So almost everybody in India owns a mobile phone. It is actually above 1.1 penetration if we take off the less than 14 years kids from our population. If we talk about the agri, we are the largest producers of cotton in the world. We are the second largest producers of food grains in the world. Okay, but quality remains a concern here. If you talk about the financial sector in India, our FDI growth over the years have been from a $9.3 billion in 2006-07 to $44 billion in 2018-19. So almost the FDI growth has gone up by 5 times in the last 10 years. Our share market capitalization, okay, has gone 10 times in the last 10 years. It was about 15 lakh crore, which is about 155 lakh crore last year. Our India is poised to have a very good demographic dividend over the years. Our average age of our population is about 29. China is about 37 as we talk. The data shows that by 2025, India's working population will be 2/3 of the total population. So the working population, so the population which will produce the gross value added, gross product for a country would be 2/3 of the population. So one of the challenges which brings in by understanding the fact that 2/3 of our population will be working population is we have to create a lot of employment in the next 4 or 5 years. And if we don't generate employment, this working population which wants to work or which has an intent to work will be counterproductive to a social economy of our country. So by looking at all this data, we are all set to grow. We are all set to achieve that 2030 mark of $10 trillion economy. But then what's happening? What are the challenges we are facing? And why we say that we are not growing as much as we want to grow? One of the factors which is a point of concern in India is the dependence on the agriculture. So the agriculture contribution to our total GDP is about 16%. And the population, the working population which is contributing the 16% is about 42%. If you compare the same data in China, the dependence on agriculture is only 7%, vis-a-vis India 16%. So when your dependence on agriculture is low in the total GDP, what happens is the efficiency in the agriculture center per worker is very low because 42% of your population is generating 16% of your income. Okay, so the per person productivity contribution to the GDP is very low in agriculture. That is what is hitting us, I think. And over the years, I think our dependence on agriculture should come down and our efficiency in the agriculture sector has to go up. Our urbanization rate is very low. So our urbanization as of now, as we speak, is about 34%. I think in 2030, if we have to touch $10 trillion economy, our urbanization should be 50% and above. China is already at 59% urbanization rate. Our labor force, So what's the concern about a labor force? I think one of the concerns with a labor force is the skill set of a labor force. I think in India, the quality of workforce is not available. So there are jobs and there is employment available in the corporate world, as well as in all other service industries, also in agriculture. But there is no skill set to fulfill the employment available. So I think there is an expectation gap of what the corporate world wants or what the employer wants and what the employees available in the market to get the job. We have a huge deficiency in terms of the basic needs to a common Indian, you know, basic needs like healthcare, education, roads, internet, housing, sanitation, banking, water. I think India has to penetrate in all these sectors to the poorest and to the rural areas of a country. If we penetrate our healthcare to rural India, if we penetrate our education to rural India, if we provide them good roads and infrastructure, their productivity will certainly go up, and this will also create a lot of jobs in our economy. So what are we doing? Government is taking a lot of initiative. There are a lot of fundamental changes happening in our economy per se. So what are those changes? One of the change which has happened, I think there are a lot of fundamental changes that the government has done in the last 3-4 years. And India is also evolving a lot on its own. Hats off to the entrepreneurs in India who are bringing this change. So one of the very revolutionary changes which has happened in India, which is also one of the topic today for the discussion, is the GST. I think GST has actually turned around the way the business will be done in future. And slowly and steadily, I think the SMEs and the small entrepreneurs are understanding the impact of GST. It is bringing a lot of discipline in the SME segment of our country. And I think it is the future. It is the future, and all of us has to get comfortable with the GST and to understand it better. And I think this is the population who will help the industry to understand GST better and to also implement it. The second revolutionary change which is happening in India is the digitization. The internet penetration in India, for the last 5 years, we have been growing multifold in the internet penetration. The internet penetration as of now is about 41%. The global internet penetration is about 57%. So we are still 16% lower than the global internet penetration, primarily because of the rural internet penetration. I think a rural internet penetration is still very, very low. Thanks to our telecom companies and thanks to the fierce competition in the telecom industry, the affordable data packages have helped India grow the internet, the data penetration in the tier 2 and the tier 3 cities. But I still think there's a huge scope of improvement in the rural areas. So digitization has changed the shape the business looks. It has changed the way the business dynamics are. It has changed the way the competition is. It has changed the way you look at your own company. You look at your profit, you look at your revenue, you look at your penetration. So digitization is a revolution. We have to get adjusted. We have to change to digitization. And I think, again, digitization is the future. If you look at the financial industry, earlier I remember when I joined SDFC 15 years back, we used to get a loan application and we used to tell the customer that, you know, it will at least take 15, 20 days to approve a loan. And that was the normal time we used to take to approve a loan. But today, if you tell 15, 20 days to a customer to approve a loan, he will call back his application. He'll say, you know, I will apply somewhere else. So you have to be fast, because his expectation is, why can't you take the data digitally from me, and why can't you process this with algorithms, and why can't you come back with a sanction in, you know, maybe the same day? So that is the challenge which every company is facing. We have adjusted towards it. We have now online application where a customer can go to the website, put in his data, and he gets a sanction within 24 hours. The next revolution change which is happening in India, the startups. I think the startup ecosystem in India is one of the better ones across the globe. We are the third largest startup generating country in the world. We have about 39,000 startups. Our growth in startups is about 270% year on year. We have generated a value of $140 billion in startups. So I think startups are doing very good in India. The government support is very good to the startups. They are creating employment, and they are creating quality employment for us. Bangalore being the hub of the startups, almost 15% of the startups are in Bangalore. So if you take Bangalore, Delhi, and Bombay, approximately some 55% of startups are in these three cities. The next transformation which is happening in digitization is the UPI, the Unified Payment Interface. So what is UPI doing to India? So if you see, if you go to a small street vendor, who is maybe, I went on Sunday evening to have some dosas in the nearby colony, and this, I for some reason I didn't carry my wallet. And I had the dosa and I realized I didn't carry my wallet. It was so easy, I could just pay him from Google Pay. So even a small street vendor is accepting payments in India from Google Pay, Phone Pay, or any other UPI platform. That's a transformation. We 5 years back, we never could imagine that a small vendor on a street will accept a payment which is for which cash is not required. Even credit cards he couldn't expect, but today Google Pay's, Phone Pay's, UPI platform is very easy. So just give you a data on UPI, we have done about 5 million transactions in UPI. Our growth in UPI payment is about 7x every year. So we are growing 7 times every year in UPI. So even now US wants to implement UPI. I think last week Google has given a paper to Federal Reserve to implement UPI in US. So the world is going crazy as to how come India is growing so much in the digitization. Then there are a lot of transformation which has happened in the real estate and the finance industry. RERA, the Real Estate Regulation Act, I think that will bring a transformation in the real estate industry. The consumer confidence will certainly go up because the consumer has some regulatory body he can go and he can vouch for the money he has given to the developer. Government has certainly taken a lot of initiative in this segment. The Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana is a big hit. The credit link subsidy scheme of the government has really taken off in India very well. The LIG and the MIG segment. We in SDFC has given about 126,000 subsidies in the last 3 years. The subsidy amount itself is about 2,800 crores. The amount we have disbursed under this subsidy was 22,000 crores. So it's a huge chunk. Nobody could ever imagine that a subsidy scheme in India can give such results. And it's very, very, I would say from a process perspective, very smooth and very easy for a consumer to get the subsidy. He may not go to any window to get the subsidy. He has to just apply a loan. And we, as the finance institution, go to NHB, get the subsidy for him, and we credit to his loan account. So basically, it's not about the subsidy. It's about the process, which is so smooth for a consumer to get the subsidy, is the reason this scheme has been so popular. In the financial sector also, I would say government has really done a good job. After the September crisis of 2018, the Island FS and the DHFL crisis, the government took a lot of measures to ensure that the liquidity is stable in the economy. They came out with a lot of schemes where the NBFCs and HFCs could take money from funds from RBI, other banks, to fulfill the liquidity crisis. One more transformation which is happening in India is the interest rates. I think interest rates has been going down for the last 2-3 years now. We have one of the lowest interest rates regime now. There is one more cut happening, which the indication the RBI governor has just given to us. And if that rate cut happens, we would be one of the lowest interest rates in the last 15-20 years. So I think that's a transformation in itself. So what's for the next 10 years? So I think we have a good platform where we think that we will grow. Our Aadhaar coverage is more than 90%. We have Jandhan account. So almost 80% of Indians have a bank account today. So only 20% are left out. So a small businessman, a person who has never ever opened a bank account, used to only deal in cash. Today he has a bank account. The ease of doing business index, India has gone from a level of 142 in 2013 to 77 in 2019. So we are improving our ecosystem for doing business. 40% increase in taxpayers. So the number of taxpayers who are in India has increased by 40%. The GST filers, there are 84 million GST filers today in India, and which has grown by 27 million since March 13. So we are all set. I think all the businessmen, maybe by force or maybe by will, are coming into a platform where they're filing returns, they want to file returns, they want to pay tax. The environment is India is surely changing. We all have to adjust to the changes. I think this fraternity can make a stark difference to the industry, where I think the industry is stumbling to cope themselves towards these changes. And it's a revolution, I can tell you. In the industry, we always think about what is the next change we have to do to cope up with the competition. And competition is always good for the industry. So it is very evident that India should grow at a much higher GDP than what it is today. It has been not growing now because there are obviously certain challenges in certain industries like real estate, automobile, infrastructure. Okay, but I'm sure the government is doing a lot of work towards it. We will surely bounce back, and we all hope that India comes to the level of 9% plus growth and we become a 10 trillion economy by 2030. I'm glad that such events are being organized by our institute and fellow members. It creates a platform to exchange knowledge and to also do networking. I give my best wishes to the organizers, chairman, for the success of this event. All the very best. Thank you.
Friends, very informative address from K.P. Aggarwal. He compared with a lot of statistics, India with China, and also he mentioned several important things are happening in India, whether it is the UPI platform, which made us proud in the world, or our startup capital of the world. Bangalore also is playing an important role in that. Our GST system or the subsidy payments reaching the end user. These are all the excellent things. India has a lot of opportunities to grow and reach, make it happen, 5 trillion, next in 2030, 10 trillion. With all our effort, we the chartered accountants can play an important role to become a leader, to lead that 5 trillion or 10 trillion economy. Thank you very much, K.P. Aggarwal, for a wonderful, fabulous address. Friends, it's a great honor to felicitate him on this occasion. I request a dignitary on the dais to felicitate him. Thank you very much, Mr. Aggarwal, for accepting our felicitation. Friends, it is my privilege to propose a vote of thanks for this inaugural session. First and foremost, our heartfelt thanks to Mr. K.P. Aggarwal for our short notice invitation. He accepted that and he spared his precious time and shared his valuable knowledge and addressed us. A wonderful, a fabulous address. Thank you very much, Mr. Aggarwal. Our special thanks to our first technical session speaker, CA Jatin Christopher. He is the resource person. Whenever we require, he is available. We are really fortunate to have you on this occasion. Thank you very much, Christopher. Thanks to our treasurer. He is with us. And thank you, last and the most important thanks to each one of you delegates. You are the reason for this conference. Thank you very much. Happy learning. Friends,